What's going on, guys? My name is Arjun and welcome back to my channel. Today I want to talk about one of the hottest things going on in the market, the SPAC, or Special Purpose Acquisition Company. I want to cover the basics of SPACs and tell you guys a few things. I want to talk about what is a SPAC and some of the terms you need to know. What are some of the main differences between SPACs and the traditional IPO process? And what are some of the upsides and downsides of SPACs for investors? The SPAC, or Special Purpose Acquisition Company, is a blank check company which raises money from the public markets with the intention of finding a private company to acquire. In 2020, which was a record year for SPACs, 248 of them came to the market, and most of them raised around $300 million. Once the SPAC comes IPO, they typically have around 2 years to find the target for their acquisition. Now let's talk about some of the most important terms that are involved in SPACs. First, the sponsor. The sponsor is the person who creates the SPAC and raises money from the investors for the IPO. The second term is the de-SPAC process. This is the process that occurs for the SPAC to merge with the private company. The last term you should know is what's known as a PIPE investment. This is a private investment in public equity. Sometimes, once the sponsor identifies the target that they want to acquire, they don't have enough money just from the IPO. So what they'll do is they'll sell more shares to other outside investors to raise the capital necessary to finish the acquisition of that company. So now let's talk about the main differences between the SPAC process and the traditional IPO process. The first is timing. In the traditional IPO, it can take anywhere from 6 to 9 months for the company to come public. Whereas in the SPAC process, it could happen in as little as 3 to 4 months. The second thing is the due diligence process. In a traditional IPO, it takes a long time and it's very extensive. The investment bank and the institutional investors will look very carefully at the financial statements given to them by the company. Whereas in a SPAC process, the due diligence is actually pretty short and not that intensive because there's no company for them to look at. They're really just looking at a holding company. And so the main due diligence that's done is in evaluating the sponsor and their capability. The third thing is in the pricing of the new shares. In a traditional IPO, this doesn't happen until the day before the IPO with any sort of certainty. Whereas in a SPAC process, this happens as soon as the negotiations are completed and the SPAC agrees to acquire the company. The fourth difference is in the amount of information available about the company at IPO. In a traditional IPO, all the information is known through a prospectus that the company has to file with the SEC. Whereas in the SPAC process, very little information is known. In fact, in most cases, all that's known is that the SPAC intends to acquire a company in a given sector, perhaps. So now let's talk about some of the upsides and downsides to SPACs. The first upside has to do with the certainty around the pricing and valuation of the company. In a traditional IPO process, it's not known until the end of that 6 to 9 month period what price the company will get for its shares and how much money they'll get. Whereas in the SPAC process, it's known quite early on. Once the negotiations occur with the company, they know how much money they're going to receive and at what price per share. This is especially important for a lot of the newer companies, which are using shares to compensate their employees to try to get the best talent. The second upside to the SPAC is the speed with which the company can come to the public market. As I stated before, the traditional IPO process is 6 to 9 months, whereas the SPAC process can be as short as 3 to 4 months. Now let's talk about some of the downsides that exist. The first one is that investors are betting solely on the sponsor. There is no company to bet on. So you're putting your trust in a sponsor's ability to find the best company. The second downside comes from the fact that the SPAC may entice a company that needs to raise money quickly, but they're not necessarily the best quality company. And this is especially important to note when the sponsor is getting closer to their two-year deadline, they may be more interested in just making a deal with any company rather than finding the best company. The third downside is the higher risk that's passed on to the retail investors. In this case, when I say retail investors, I'm specifically talking about people who are buying the SPAC after it's already IPO'd and it's trading on the public market, but before it's found the acquisition target. Those investors lose out on two key benefits of not getting into the SPAC at the IPO. Those two benefits are having the ability to get your investment returned to you if you don't like the acquisition target, or having the ability to get more shares if you really like the acquisition target. I hope you guys were able to learn a little bit about SPACs from this video. If you want me to go into further detail or talk about anything else specifically with SPACs, let me know in the comments. Thank you guys for watching this, and if you enjoyed it and want to learn more about business and investing, comment, like, and subscribe to my channel, and let's head on over to the next video.